podcast. Yay!
It's ridiculously over the top.
Okay, let's go. Ben, do you want to hear the new theme music?
I can't believe we have new theme music.
We got new theme music from our new professional theme music making person.
Who is very professional.
You're very professional.
I'm really, very, very thankful to.
You're really going to enjoy this. Let's get the theme music going. It's really good.
Does it hold true to the essence of the original theme music?
I'll let you judge.
Okay, I'm really excited now.
Okay, can I play it?
Yeah, I'm sorry.
You're going to like it.
Theme music for the podcast. We don't actually have any theme music, so someone will probably make one up for us. I don't want to name any. Rachel. I hope it's Rachel that does that for the podcast.
You're an absolute dick. I was so sure there was an actual podcast music.
No, Ben, it was the old music.
Yeah, I got that after about 1 second.
I played it for a fool.
So yeah, I suppose it really did keep true to the essence of the original.
Stunningly so.
Yeah, stunningly so.
Perhaps some people have said that it was too similar.
Who has said that?
Me.
Right. Okay.
Yeah.
So no one important then.
Ben, there seems to be a kind of disembodied third person here.
Can you feel the presence in the room?
There's a presence.
A presence.
We might get to that later.
Yeah. There's now a vocal presence in the room.
There is. There's definitely someone else here.
Voice from the outer world.
Now.
Can you hear that?
Can you hear what?
Oh, this is the magic of podcasts. Ben, you might be surprised to learn that we've had another listener's letter.
Oh, have we? We have now.
We've actually had this listener letter on Twitter.
I've been stung before.
We've had it at our Twitter handle, yeah. @MickandBen.
At Mick and Ben. Because we're on Twitter now.
We are on Twitter now. @MickandBen. This is from Totally Real Mike from Saskatchewan, who you might remember from last week.
Oh, he's a long-time listener.
Long-time listener.
And now second time.
Tweeter. He tweeted us again.
He said,
thanks for the shout-out from last week, guys. Maybe you aren't such hosers. Hey. And he's responding. Yeah. He's responding to our question about Saskatchewan's provincial status.
Oh, wonderful, because it did keep me awake once or twice this week.
So once again, this is from Totally Real Mike.
Okay.
@TotallyRealMike on Twitter. And he says that Saskatchewan is, in fact, a province.
Oh, okay.
In Western Canada.
Western Canada.
The only province without natural borders.
Yeah, it was me thinking they all had natural
borders. No, not Saskatchewan. It does have an area of 651,900 square kilometres.
Okay.
And nearly 10% of that is water.
10%?
Yeah.
Goodness.
Mostly rivers, reservoirs, and the province's 100,000 beautiful lakes.
There are 100,000 beautiful lakes.
According to Totally Real Mike.
According to Totally Real Mike, who really, like, knuckled down and did some very factual, objective writing on the subject.
Yeah.
Like the kind you'd find on a popular internet site that documents things like that.
Wikipedia-esque. But obviously he didn't copy it from that.
Because he's totally real.
Totally real. Totally real, Mike.
Took the time.
Yeah, so it's nice to have a recurring
Listener.
It's nice to have a listener.
It's nice to have any listeners, but a recurring one is twice as nice.
Yeah. So, Ben, big kind of comic book movie TV news this week was Guardians of the Galaxy.
Yeah.
I assume you've seen it.
You assume incorrectly.
So you haven't seen it?
Do not spoil a damn thing.
So, mysterious voice, I assume you've seen it.
I haven't seen it.
Great.
I haven't seen the first one either.
I wish the disembodied voice had mentioned this before.
Okay, so we're going to cancel the podcast, and then we got
4 minutes and 42 seconds.
Okay.
I know what happened. I've seen a lot of the clips on YouTube.
In the first one or the second?
The first one. I haven't seen anything in the second one.
Mysterious voice, why don't you tell us the story?
Yeah, you tell us the first story of Guardians of the Galaxy.
The story of the Guardians of the Galaxy begins with a young man whose name is Peter Quill.
That's right so far. Well done.
He's sitting alone in a hospital.
Yeah, that's true.
his stepfather is hovering around.
Ah! It's his granddad.
It's his granddad.
Yeah, foiled.
Well, I didn't see the whole thing.
Gotcha.
He's listening to some music while his mother slowly dies. Flash forward for a while, blah-de-blah-de-blah. He becomes a wannabe nefarious space pirate, steals this thing. Somebody else is trying to steal the thing. Meets up with the other people who they eventually call themselves the Guardians of the Galaxy. They have adventures. They save the day. The end.
Yeah, that's pretty much it.
Yeah, kind of nailed it.
Hard to argue with that.
No, not going to lie, that was pretty solid.
So, will I give you my thoughts on the new one?
If you want, but I swear to God, if you spoil anything, this podcast is over.
and Groot's not dead.
Oh, that's okay.
I was very tense there for a second.
I was actually
in the after credit scene in the first
one. I was actually going to give pretend spoilers by saying that Vin Diesel dies at the end, because they were the infamous spoilers from Fast 8. Fate, but 8 of the Furious. But then I realised that Vin Diesel is actually in this movie, and he did actually die in the first one. So you can't
start messing around with that.
It would have been a confusing non-spoiler. Anyway, look, it's good. It's a very good film. It's a very enjoyable film. I really enjoyed it.
Good.
It's long.
How long are we talking?
It's 2.5 hours.
Ooh.
2.5 hours.
It's a chunky life.
Yeah, but that's 2.5 hours from first reel to end of credits, because you have to stay for the credits.
Yeah, well, it's Marvel.
To Marvel's credit, 5 post-credit scenes. But that means that they don't feel like a post-credit scene.
They just feel like a mini-movie.
It feels like the movie just keeps going through the credits. You don't have to do that bloody sitting in the cinema waiting, going, there better be a bloody scene at the end of this, or else I'm going to be really angry. You've got a minute, then a little scene, then 2 minutes, then a little scene.
They keep you coming back for more little breadcrumbs.
Exactly, yeah.
Breadcrumb scenes.
And it works really good. The movie itself, very good. I'm not going to, no spoilers, no details. Probably the most special effect-y film I've ever seen.
Really?
Yeah, more so than Avatar, which I've seen.
Not everybody in the room has.
Not everybody in the room has seen Avatar.
Because you don't really, it's not
more than Beowulf.
Oh, well, Beowulf wasn't real, though. You know what I mean?
Well, hang on.
Guardians of the Galaxy is real. Don't hang on. Look,
I don't want to start with a disembodied voice, but it makes a valid argument.
No, but Beowulf was...
Listen to the voice.
Who said that? Beowulf was an animated movie. Wasn't it? It was an animated movie.
But it focused heavily on motion graphic capture and things like that.
But it was still an animated movie.
Ray Charles actually was originally cast in the role, and then they realised that he had some issues in the sight department, and he couldn't do his own stunts.
I got my Grendel when she's in need. Oh, what? Grendel's mother is fine indeed.
Oh, she's a monster. It's under a lake. That has a really, really, really bad song.
No, look, that's going to be the theme music for the podcast for next week. Look, it's good. It's a good movie. It's the most special effects heavy live action movie I've ever seen. And really, I don't know why I noticed that.
Okay.
You know what I mean? But I noticed it a lot more than I did with, say, Avatar, which was probably more special effects heavy, but it just
felt... And also a very, very bad film that I will not endorse in this podcast without saying is terrible.
I thought this podcast was sponsored by Avatar.
No, but if Avatar does want to sponsor us, I will print a retraction in next week's podcast.
One thing that I can say without spoilers...
Yes.
...is I don't know what it was. I think it says more about me personally and my issues.
Okay.
But I was very attracted to Nebula.
Nebula as in... Karen...
No, I don't really care for Karen Gillan. I can take or leave Karen Gillan.
But you'll take her in full Nebula.
Nebula, oh.
It does say a lot about your taste.
Yeah.
Because she's, like, mostly machine.
And very angry.
Very angry.
And very sexy.
Very angry.
Sexy angry.
For those that can't see Mick, by the way, he also has very short hair and he's redheaded. So I don't know if there's something like that going
on. I'm not redheaded.
Are you sure?
I'm not red. I have a red beard. I have not red hair. I want a retraction... Unless red-haired people want to sponsor the podcast.
Okay. He's a redhead, ladies and gentlemen. Don't let the
I'm not a redhead.
Don't let the you look at our little logo on this podcast and see if it doesn't scream he's actually a redhead to you.
Look, let's finish talking about this. It was very good. You know what was weird? Just before it started, I started feeling nervous.
Because you thought they were gonna
I don't know.
Screw the run. Screw the pooch.
I don't screw the run.
Screw, is that a thing? Screw the run up.
Yeah.
Is it?
The run of the
success.
Five planned.
I like the disembodied voice. I'm bringing the disembodied voice back every week.
No, but I genuinely felt nervous before it started. I think Guardians of the Galaxy is one of my favorite films.
I think it's one of the best Marvel films that they've made. I think it's unique. I think it's interesting. I think it's well made.
And how do you follow that up?
That was a question.
Well, look, we'll talk about it more next week because
I will see it during the week because I'm a terrible podcast co-host and didn't see it this week.
Okay, let's move on.
Okie doke.
We have our first guest.
Yes! The aforementioned disembodied voice.
Disembodied voice.
Who is a real person. Would you like to introduce yourself?
No, I'm going to introduce him. I have a bit. I'm doing the bit.
He's doing a bit.
I've stepped all over the bit. I've stepped all over the bit.
Hold on. Ask me who that is.
Who even is that, Mick?
Ben, this man has a very particular set of skills that he's acquired over a very long career. Skills that make him a nightmare for people like Ben. If you have him on your podcast now, that'll be the end of it. If you don't, he'll look for you. He'll find you. And he will kill you. It's Clive!
I thought it was Liam Neeson. But I'll take Clive.
Clive has actually been described as a real life Liam Neeson.
By who?
Me, just now. But if Liam Neeson, if a Liam Neeson character were to come to life,
mm-hmm.
it would be Clive. Yes.
It will be Clive.
So we have Clive here for a special reason today, because we're going to talk about martial arts in pop culture. Martial arts in comic book movies and TV. And
excellent.
There is no better man to combine these two worlds, even though he hasn't seen Avatar, than Clive.
Okay, good. Excellent. That's good, because I know nothing about martial arts.
That's true. So why don't you...
Or their application in real life.
So why don't you ask Clive some questions then?
Well, Clive, when did you start studying martial arts?
Studying.
Oh, sorry. God, oh, no.
Oh, this is awful. Why did we get Ben to ask the question?
I'm sorry. What did I do wrong this time?
Doing martial arts.
When did you start?
Or is it studying?
One neither studies nor does martial arts. Martial arts is something that binds us and flows through us.
Wow.
Okay. I've been doing it since I was a little kid in my local church hall.
And
basically.
And now,
doing it or studying it or anything else like that.
For those who can't see Clive, he is no longer a little kid.
No.
He's quite a bit larger than a little kid.
Yes, he's quite a grizzled gentleman.
Quite. Liam Neeson was an apt.
It's like a real life Liam Neeson character.
Mm.
Did I say Liam Neeson or Neam Leeson?
Neil Leeson is a very.
So, Clive, what are martial arts that you do?
I started off as a young nipper doing taekwondo in my local church hall. And for anyone who doesn't know about it, a lot of the kicks and spinny kicks and things like that you see in martial arts and comic book films come from taekwondo originally. Then moved on to a lot of other things, kickboxing. And at the moment I'm involved in wrestling, mixed martial arts, that kind of side of martial arts that is less impressive looking and just more realistic.
More realistic. Okay.
So the cool stuff is the taekwondo.
The cool looking stuff.
But the really cool stuff is what you're doing now.
Well, depends if you're making McGregor money or not. The rest of us aren't.
We're gonna bring up McGregor money.
Yeah, well, you know, we train in the same gym.
Huh. Huh.
But, well, I coach in that gym for my sins. But for most people involved in MMA, it's just a hobby. Something nice to do. Make a few friends, get in shape, beat the head off each other, go home.
Bog standard.
Have a few drinks. everybody's happy. Occasionally somebody rises and makes a load of money. Most people don't really have the interest in
making a large amount of money.
No.
So what you're saying is, Clive, that you are not paying for the first round after the podcast today.
Well, you know.
That's
depends,
a maybe.
It depends what you're drinking.
I
may be able to stretch.
It's on record now.
A certain amount.
We have it officially on record.
If Clive wants to sponsor the podcast...
You can't do so.
To the extent of two drinks.
And Clive, I've heard people...
Medium price drinks.
Two average price drinks. I have heard people say that you own more black belts than Ben does pairs of classy trousers.
I think you're the only person who knows us both, so...
You're the only person that has the answer for this.
Have you been listening to yourself talking about our trousers and belts?
Yes. I've been making notes. What I really mean is...
have to give a bit of background to that.
To the layman.
Yes.
The impressive thing about martial arts is black belts.
Cool belts.
Belts. So, can you tell us two things? Either tell us one... And this will be the simple answer, and this will be the sound bite. How many cool belts do you have?
Two.
And two cool belts, excellent.
Two cool belts.
And two, what does that really mean in real life?
Not much.
But you're disavowing me of most of my notions. Surely black belts are the most
equate
important
to
thing.
Stature. And because I am a layman. Sorry, just to be very, very clear there, I always thought that black belts were how you became, you know, Grandmaster of the universe and
a super cool killing machine
who
always has a quip ready to go.
Basically Liam Neeson. I've been misled. I was told real life Liam Neeson, and apparently that is not the case.
I actually told Ben we were just having Liam Neeson on the podcast.
I've been holding back tears because my mind is very, very sensitive. If you hear a slight guttural like it's probably me trying to hold back some emotions.
So they're not that important then?
Well, I mean, they're nice from a personal point of view. It's recognition from your peers and your coach and whatever else you have. And, I mean, it is an indication of a particular level at a particular martial art. But it doesn't mean you're suddenly unbeatable or you're suddenly able to go out and fight against 20 people in a crowded Lewis.
How far up the food chain do you have to get before you can fight against 20 people on a crowded Lewis?
I would like to know this too.
That really, that's more just a matter of experience. You just got to get on the red line every day. Just put in the hours, grind it out. I mean, it's...
Ben, would you like to explain what a Lewis is?
Yeah, so for anyone listening in a country that isn't Ireland or from a city that isn't Dublin, the Lewis is the light rail system. In Dublin City, it is run by a private company.
It's not public.
A company that we really like here at the podcast. And if that company would like to sponsor us, they can get in touch with us and then I will say their name. I'm on air, so just let us know. No, but for real, tram system in Dublin. Not known to be the safest of tram systems in Dublin, occasionally.
Okay, that's fair. Okay, let's get on to why we brought Clive here.
Yes.
Clive is going to... He's going to roll his... Do you want to be called an expert or do you like avoiding that term?
I don't mind, yeah.
Okay, Clive's going to roll his expert eyes over some famous or infamous martial arts in pop culture. And we're going to take a look at it and he's going to tell us if it's good, is it bad, is it realistic, what type of martial arts are they doing, is it real martial arts or is it makey-uppy martial arts?
What type of fake martial arts are they doing?
What type of fake martial arts?
Actually, can I just go back and say... Yeah, let's not call me an expert, just in case I ever end up in court.
Yeah.
Say, oh, well, we have you written down here as an expert. And say, an enthusiast of the martial arts.
Okay, that's fair. Although, I would love the idea of this podcast being used as evidence in court.
that'd be unique.
Something has gone wrong in one of our lives. Okay, Clive, we'll let you pick what sort of scenes you want to talk about.
Okay, I think first one we briefly mentioned, I've seen, it's not a series I've watched at all, but Daredevil
okay.
has a particularly famous hallway fight scene.
Yes, it does.
It does, which they've mimicked in every single one of their Netflix shows since, because they put two and two together and said, holy superhero money. They didn't do it as effectively in the first one. Daredevil is, for anyone that doesn't know, the 2015 Netflix series starring Charlie Cox as the aforementioned... There was a lot of emphasis on Cox in that sentence.
And we have a podcast title. Episode 3,
Emphasis on Cox.
Very good.
That's Cox with an X, by the way. Probably one of the strongest Netflix series there, pilot series for this whole run on kind of gritty Netflix superhero.
Yeah, lines. I agree. I think maybe Jessica Jones might have been better, but season 1 of Daredevil was very good.
I think Jessica Jones, in terms of overall writing and performance, is better, but in terms of excellent comic book adaptation, I think maybe Daredevil might pull ahead on that. Okay. Anyway.
Yeah, let's get to this. We're going to roll this. Clive's going to scan it with his casual interest brain. And we're going to stop
in
it
no
there.
In no way legally qualified. So
this is Clive's entirely non-legally binding opinion on Marvel's Deadflix. Marvel, Netflix, Daredevil fight scene.
Mm-hmm.
Hold on. Modern technology. Here we go. You just tell me to pause it there, Clive, and anytime you want.
Can we pause it there? Just for a sec.
There we go.
Because I haven't watched Daredevil. I've seen clips of it. Can you put it in context for me? Why are his hands wrapped that way? Is there some reason?
So for those who aren't watching the video and are listening on a mobile cellular device, what's actually happening here is you see Daredevil in his initial costume, which is nothing more than a black kind of cowl made of cloth.
Mm-hmm.
And then he has two... What actually looks to be oven mitts? They look a little like oven mitts.
With a little bit of insulating tape around them.
Oven mitts and insulating tape, which for those that don't know, are actually what real professional MMA fighters wear in the ring.
I think it is. I think what he's going to do now is he's going to punch some men. What's happened in this scene is a child has been kidnapped, and Daredevil has used his heightened senses to track them down. And now he's going to go in and he's going to beat everyone.
Because he's rather against kidnapped children.
Yeah, he's going to bang
some
guys.
So there was no context behind his hands being wrapped like that.
Well, it's a bit cold in New York.
I'm going to be going fighting some people. I'm going to wrap my hands like I've seen people do in the movies.
Yes.
And now he's done that. So hang on, just so I can understand. This isn't a real thing that happens, and my MMA fact was not a fact.
Well, it's just... what he's done to his hands is essentially wearing a pair of fingerless gloves. Like a clerk. The wrapping of his hands makes it look like a cool fighter. But, I mean, there's no wrist support. There's no knuckle protection. It's essentially just putting a bit of gauze over your knuckles and wrapping it around and say, hey, back off.
Here I go. I've
got tape. I've got tape on my hands. But that's an aside.
So I'm not to do this when I go and start training.
I'll wrap your hands.
Oh, okay, grand. Awesome.
So what you're saying is, this is supposed to be the good one, by the way. This is supposed to be the good fight that we compare all the others to. This has started poorly.
No, but the actual scene itself may improve. It's just a little bit of...
Okay, so the hand wraps mean nothing.
Yeah.
Oven mitts. Yeah, oven
okay.
Just a little bit of...
combat oven mitts.
Yeah.
So again, you say pause when you want, Cliff.
Do you want me to roll all it right there? Look, he looks tough. He's contemplative.
Yeah.
If he wasn't blind, he'd have a really keen look in his eye. He'd be like...
blind people can still have a look in their eye.
Not when they have a cowl over their head that blocks their eye from view.
Oh, no. If any blind people want to sponsor the podcast, I really apologise for Ben's comments.
Actually, really save your money and donate it to Guide Dogs Ireland. don't give it to the podcast. I will not accept it.
There's a bit of a preamble here.
So he's putting his fingers up against the door.
And
he's sensing what's happening on the other side.
And now he's in.
And now...
so we have Daredevil here. He's punching some people. We've actually lost sight of him now.
Yeah.
And he's going to kick a guy through this door any second now. Bang! I've preempted that. Bang!
There he is. Yeah.
Now, can we stop it there?
Okay.
Now, there was, what, maybe 5 or 6 people in that room?
Oh, we could check. But yeah, let's say 5 or 6.
5 or 6. And I don't know if he could sense it at that point, but... probably more in the other room. You can see one just coming out now.
I think at the very least we can say We try to choose non-superpowered fights.
Yeah.
Because that's as much realism as we can fit in.
Yeah. But we could I'd at least say that by touching the door, he knew where they were in the room. Yeah. Does that make a difference?
Yes. Then my issue is, he went into the room.
Mm-hmm.
Fair enough, he wants to get in, get the initial surprise, get the drop on them. But his greatest advantage, one person against many, is going to be in the hallway.
Right.
So as soon as he threw somebody through that door, he should have been straight out. But he's just kind of hanging around with maybe five or six people around him having a scrap when he could be fighting one or two at a time in the hallway.
What about the guy with the gun?
Yeah, well, that's why I can understand him going in initially to disarm him.
Because he's going for that guy.
He's going for that guy.
But he should have come right back out.
Got to get in, get the drop on him, disarm the one really dangerous guy. Now I'm going to leg it back to where I have my more even fight.
Okay, shall we move on?
Let's go.
Okay.
So ooh, this guy's got some swag. Oh, he had some swagger.
He got a whack of a microwave.
No, he's doing it exactly right here. Look, he's lining them all up. He's not letting everybody come at him at the same time.
These gentlemen appear to have forgotten how to use their guns, though.
Yeah.
That often happens in films. It's
the excitement of the rough and
tumble. Ammunition amnesia. The excitement of the rough and tumble.
So this is kind of what this scene is particularly famous for. This breather he needs to take every now and then.
Yeah.
And, you know, we're watching him. How realistic is how easily he's knocking people down?
How easily he's knocking people down? Quite realistic.
Oh, really?
Apart from this guy who has an iron head. I mean, people knock down pretty easily. The only problem is, what's happening here, they're being knocked down, rolling around on the floor for a little while, gently getting back up, composing themselves and attacking them again.
Right.
I mean, you can knock someone down pretty easy, but they get up pretty easy again.
Okay.
Okay.
If you really knock someone out, they're like the guy in the far right-hand corner up against the door who is out cold.
So all these guys who are crawling around the ground going, oh, look, he got a burst of energy, that one guy there.
Suddenly, as soon as he turned his back.
He was like, oh, I'm wow, surprise!
Yeah.
So that's the kind of less realistic thing about this, then.
Yeah. I mean, it's...
I mean, this is famous for a bunch of reasons. It's mainly that the camera angle never changes. It's one long rolling shot as well. Like, there's a couple of reasons it got a lot of prep.
Didn't like that kick.
Yeah, it was a bit of a pointless flourish, really.
Is there any such thing as a pointless flourish?
Well,
is there any such thing as a useful flourish?
Well, we have to assume in context he doesn't know that somebody's videoing this.
Well, I hope not.
Yeah, so it was kind of pointless in that he's just wasted a load of energy. Somebody who was unconscious in the corner, he did a big spinning kick and kind of kicked him in the bum. And now he's kind of awake again.
Perhaps he used his Daredevil senses to detect that that guy's weak spot was his bum.
He's got a dicky hip.
Ah! Daredevil kicked me in a sore hip.
How did you know exactly where my weakness was?
Oh. Well, I'm 2 weeks past my transplant.
I feel really bad for that guy, though, because it costs a lot of money to get a hip transplant in.
So, Clive, then what martial arts is he using?
He is general scrapping.
Right.
He used some Taekwondo.
Mm-hmm.
It's an interesting. Any Taekwondo people, he opted to use a crescent kick rather than a turning kick.
He's in a
hallway, and it's much easier to cut a crescent kick in a narrow space than a turning kick, or if you're listening from the States, roundhouse kick, as you call it over there.
I hope they're not listening.
This is gold.
Chuck Norris special roundhouse kick. Turning kick.
So do you like that one?
Yeah, it's good. It's good. A couple of little things, but I mean, you know, you can suspend your disbelief about wearing ridiculous...
Well, we're not about suspensive disbelief here, I'm afraid. You're going to have to go into the nitty-gritty and tear them apart.
So wait a minute. Your biggest issue with the whole thing is the hand wraps.
Oven mitts.
The oven mitts.
It starts off setting just an interesting tone of, you know, what is a relatively gritty fight scene.
Mm-hmm.
Somebody who is... kind of like an 80s pop star wearing gloves. You know, be Madonna, could have been Michael Jackson. I mean, they're largely irrelevant to any. That's why I asked the question at the start. I was like, had he burned his hands before, or like, okay, was there some reason his hands were wrapped up by that? Was he just out of hospital? Like, he had one roll of tape around his wrist.
His hands are fine, aren't they? I don't remember the context.
I can't remember the exact context. I just like mitts of justice.
Mitts of justice.
Mitts of justice.
I like 80s pop star. I have to stay. Stand and deliver. Kiss that child all your life.
Yeah. Oh. It could be like a Rock of Ages adaptation kind of thing.
Yeah.
Very good.
Anyway, next.
What else do we have?
What else do you want?
I've gone blank. What? Give me a suggestion.
We can cut out blank spaces. So
No, don't worry too much.
Yeah. Okay, what about... Let's look at kind of... Okay, let me do that again. Let's look at kind of an antithesis. Antithesis to that fight. It's another
wrong. Sorry. I just wanted to be included. Sorry.
Oh, Ben. Ben Sorry. Felt left out.
I felt left out.
Ben, what was your favorite martial arts technique in that Daredevil fight?
I really enjoyed the crouching iron lotus position that he adapts at the beginning.
God. Stop. Oh, my brain hurts.
Sorry, you're right. I actually misspoke there. It was the crouching copper lotus position.
Oh, stop it. You could have at least said the crescent kick or something Clive said.
I don't want to sound like a parrot. I want to have my own views on the... My own misinformed views on the martial arts.
If we wanted to hear your views on the martial arts, we wouldn't have got Clive here.
I've watched lots of 80s movies. I know martial arts.
Okay, let's take a look at kind of...
Top Gun.
It's perfectly fine for a man in his 30s to have not seen Top Gun. It's fine. It's totally normal. Everything is fine.
Do you remember last week when Mick gave me hassle for not seeing Lethal Weapon 2? Well, we found out today that Mick hasn't seen Top Gun.
Hoist by my own petard. Oh, how the tables have turned.
I'd like to thank Coach Clive for coming on the podcast and just making everything a little bit fairer. Just like to extend my warm thanks.
So we're going to look... are we going to get this done? We're going to look at... we're going to look at a scene which, to me, I think is kind of the antithesis. Opposite.
Antithesis.
It's the opposite. It's the opposite of that one. But also kind of the same. Ben, I don't know anything about this. Iron Man 2, give us some details.
Iron Man 2 is largely recognised as probably the weakest of the trilogy.
The red-haired stepchild.
The red-haired stepchild of the trilogy. It was directed by Jon Favreau, who did not get to reprise it his director position in the third one. Shane Black took over.
Didn't get to or didn't want to?
I think it was a little bit of both. I think there was kind of a mix between Jon Favreau was like, I would like to do it my way again, and Marvel was like, oh, we're going to need a little bit more studio interference this time. Sorry, there were just a couple of moments in that last one. Wasn't sure about Mickey Rourke with the L... chest out all the time, the whips, there's a few angles going on there, maybe just tone it down next time.
Some Marvel executive sitting in there in his office thumping the table going, more oven mitts!
More oven mitts. Look, we focus tested the oven mitts, they work. The kids want oven mitts. Get them in there.
Okay, so this next one is Iron Man 2, and it's the delectable Scarlett Johansson kicking some guys' asses. Let's take a quick look. We'll have Ben provide us with some sort of witty repartee while she's changing.
So, for those into gratuitous scenes, this one is quite good. Happy, who is played by Jon Favreau, which is a little bit conceited because he's directing the movie, but hey, is driving Tony Stark's assistant, who it turns out is actually an undercover S.H.I.E.L.D. agent.
The Black Widow.
He's now trying to help her to stop a security breach, which is helpfully being shown to us by the large words, security breach.
I think they're causing the security breach, though. They're not stopping it. They are the security breach.
So, Clive, feel free at any point.
Yeah, this bit with Jon Favreau is really good. He's having a nice scrap with one of the guards. They're both doing realistic things. They're covering up when they're being hit. They're returning punches. Nice back and forth. If they had just left the camera on them for the whole thing, it would have been pretty sweet. Instead, we focus on Black Widow.
The Black Widow.
Why do you think we focus on Black Widow?
Because it appears the fight choreographer thinks that I don't really have to do anything now because I got a pretty girl.
I just
put in a whole heap of crap. Like a couple of seconds ago, she threw two, I assume they're electrical charges.
Yeah, that's fine. Electricity is damaging.
Electricity is damaging, but if you throw two at someone's feet, where does that circuit connect? It just goes up through their legs, into their groin, and makes them go, oh. It's not going to knock somebody out.
For those that can't see, Clive, who is a rather large, intimidating man, I just met Clive for the first time today, just kind of put his hands out to the side and wiggled a little bit to show us what they were like.
I mean, it wasn't enough electricity to cause any burning. It was just enough to give a shock. So if you're going to do any damage with it, you've got to put it across somebody's chest, not just give them a little zap in their nuggets.
We've now got a toss up between emphasis on cocks and zapping the nuggets. The podcast next.
Okay, let's keep going.
Zap them in the nuggets.
Yeah, let's see more Black Widow ridiculousness.
But she's got all these combat skills.
And her hair's on point.
Now, if we stop it there for a second.
Whoa.
If you go back, I remember it caught my eye when I saw this the first time. If you go back and look at this scene,
mm-hmm.
A guy appears behind her.
Right, hold on. Let me see if
and
I can find him.
What that means is that this super assassin, highly trained expert killer, is penetrating a building and isn't checking the corridors on either side of her.
She doesn't need to.
She's Black Widow, she'll be fine.
She's taking people out.
Like, turned around the corner and was behind her. That means he was in the corridor running towards her and she didn't even notice. She maybe just happened to turn around and there he was.
Maybe he has those silent shoes that ninjas wear.
She's a super assassin. Surely she would go, look left, look right. I mean, that's what you teach children when they're crossing the road.
It does seem like it would be covered in shield training.
Day one in assassin school. if you're going into a building.
Oh, Black Widow wasn't even trained by SHIELD. She was trained by the KGB.
Yeah.
The Red Wing.
Red Room
training.
I think on the first day, though, they don't cover looking left and right. They just remove your uterus.
Oof.
Was that not later in her training?
That was her graduation. Sorry.
Did they take her uterus away?
Hold on a second. Have you not seen Age of Ultron?
I have, but I didn't. I seem to have blanked that particular...
They took out her lady parts.
I did not know they took those away.
Lady parts, not the outside.
I figured as much. She needs the assets in the field. Honeypotting people left, right,
God,
and center.
Ben.
What?
Can't say that on a podcast.
Sorry.
Anyway, let's move on. Let's see more of this. She hit that guy in the nuts just using the old-fashioned method.
Yeah. Wasn't any real special move there. She just kind of slid along the ground.
Hit him in the nuts.
What if the guy with the old wax machine hadn't done that corridor and she tried to slide along it?
If it wasn't a buffed corridor.
Yeah.
What are those wax machines called?
Buffer.
Are they?
No, it's a buffer.
Oh, okay. Thanks. So here we go. Okay, here's the guy who snuck up behind her. But she got him in a head scissors, Clive. Surely that's real.
Head scissors. But wait till we see the next head scissors. The next most ridiculous move in this entire thing. Two lads still have a good scrap in the background.
Oh, more things.
Yeah, more.
Oh, exactly, smoke bombs.
And one guy unconscious from being gently knocked on the ground.
So, are these guys going to sleep too easily?
Go to sleep.
Yeah. Hang on, we'll keep going.
This guy. Look at this. He's got a head scissors.
Swinging around. Now, if you go back and look at that, she does a big, huge hurricane rada, flips up, gets him in head scissors. Then lets go of his head with her legs, holds on to his arm, lets go of his arm. And basically, what she actually does is stands in front of him and throws him on the ground. She ran at him, did a whole load of spinny stuff that didn't do anything, killed all the momentum she had, and then did a little trip and threw him into the ground.
But that would take him out, surely.
But surely. The trip might, but all the spinny stuff is just... fight choreographer going, yeah, so we had the zap in the nuggets, we had the smoke bombs, she uses her little shoelaces to tie the guy up, spinny stuff, throw in some spinny stuff, and finish it off, just chuck him on the ground.
Which martial arts is she doing?
rubbish.
Rubbish martial arts.
The closest thing is actually a Vietnamese martial art called Viet Vo Dao.
Okay.
They do a lot of head scissors and takedowns, and but they actually do them. They don't just spin around and then let go and choke you on the ground.
Are they more effectual or as ineffectual?
They would probably be as ineffectual.
So polite. Being
diplomatic.
How diplomatic? You have to be diplomatic with the Vietnamese.
Yeah, they've been through a lot.
They have. It's been a tough couple of years.
Okay, let's get through Black Widow here.
Now, she manages to elbow him in the nose despite holding onto his wrist. Now, I don't know anyone who could do that.
I could do it.
No, you couldn't.
Okay, fair enough. What about these lads? Look, this is the comic.
See, this is the real fight. Boom. Nice uppercut to finish. The guy's been in the scrap for the last 5 minutes. And finally, he's out and he's staying down. All these other people, the guy who got zapped in the nuggets is still out cold. How did that happen?
Maybe his nuggets were
his nuggets were not ready.
Spot. Like the hip guy.
He just had a nugget replacement.
Yeah. Oh, I'm 2 weeks out from my nugget replacement. Black Widow has zapped me.
Straight in the nuggets.
What about the guy who got maced in the face?
Yeah.
He's unconscious somehow as well.
Is that not what mace does?
No, it just burns your
eyes.
Even
I know that's not what mace does.
I know, I'm feigning ignorance.
Oh, sorry.
For the sake of the podcast.
The guy who got elbowed in the nose has decided, maybe my body better shut down because this nose is so preposterous that she was able to elbow me from there and just go to sleep.
Do you think that they might be not that well paid and just not that into getting back up and fighting anymore?
Well, I can understand that, but if somebody zapped you in the nuggets, you'd be pretty upset.
If.
You would.
If. If.
If.
And I mean,
it's never happened.
You can understand.
Thankfully, yeah.
They don't particularly want to protect Hammer Industries' secrets.
Yeah.
But zapping the nuggets is zapping the nuggets.
It's true.
Do you think they might have been pulling their punches because they're fighting a lady? A very attractive lady.
I don't think so. I think the fight choreographer was pulling his time of not bothering because putting Scarlett Johansson, I don't really have to do anything. Let me a little
bit more gymnastics.
What I'm going to do is I'm going to go with these guys, you know, the stunt guys. We're going to go have a few drinks. Do a bit of training. And we'll see if we can do some flips outside. It'd be cool.
Flips are cool.
And you guys just shoot the scene. It'll be fine.
Okay. Let's do a DC one. Lest we are accused of being Marvel fanboys.
Do me a DC. Never ever accuse me of being a Marvel fanboy. That would greatly hurt my feelings.
Would it?
It would, actually.
That's ammo.
We'll use it later. We'll use it later.
Shall we go Batman Superman or we do Watchmen?
Batman Superman.
The greatest film of 2016.
If you're functionally blind and deaf.
Like Daredevil?
That's true, actually. Yeah,
he's not deaf.
It would be much worse.
Okay, so we're
functionally blind either. It's just legally.
Do you want to do us a lead in, Ben?
Yeah, let's do a little lead in.
Or was Martha?
So,
which Martha?
Is Martha important in Batman vs Superman?
That's not.
We'll never tell. No. So in this case, Martha has been kidnapped.
Yeah.
Where's Martha?
And Batman.
Which Martha has been kidnapped?
Martha Kent.
Yes.
Martha Kent. The mother of Superman. The adopted mother of Superman. Very important there because Superman's not from this planet. Don't tell Donald Trump. He probably will have him kicked out.
No politics, Ben.
Sorry, no politics at all.
No politics on
sorry,
the podcast.
Sorry. If Donald Trump does want to sponsor the podcast, please don't. Moving on from there. So anyway, she's been kidnapped.
Yeah.
Batman's tracked her down
because
he's Batman. World's greatest detective.
Yes.
It's all about to kick off, really. Right. You can see there's a little bit of skittering going on among the henchmen. The main henchman has said, "You two go check the window."
Okay.
So these two guys are going to go check the window.
He also, I think, he's done a scan or something, like a body heat scan.
Body heat scan.
Where Alfred is on the thing, going, "Oh, Master Wayne, there's loads of the buggers."
I'm detecting several dozen on the third floor. I should drop you off in the second.
Yes, exactly. So, like Daredevil.
Alfred, I don't deserve you. See, I know you don't.
You've watched this a few times, haven't you? So like Daredevil.
Hang on, just let me enjoy this. I really enjoyed that. Just let me take that in.
Like Daredevil, we can assume that Batman.
No, Batman.
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 That's what they have in cricket.
Bruce Batman knows where the bad guys are.
Yes.
Okay, let's go. Let's roll it. Roll it there, Roisin. So, here we are.
A lot of tension.
Yeah.
All thinking Batman is going to come in through this door.
Oh, he's coming through the floor.
What?
And he manages to get zappers on all their guns.
Now, pew. Are these zappers better or worse than Black Widow's zappers?
They seem to be explosive.
They seem to do things. Yeah. And I mean, they're targeting something that could be affected by a zapper.
A gun. Right.
Not nuts. No nuggets. No nuggets were harmed.
Look, this guy's shooting at the wrong place.
I didn't even realize Batman's in the room.
Here he is. Oh, there he is. Ben Affleck.
Batfleck.
Thanks, Ben.
I wasn't letting it go. Sorry, it has to be done.
So he's dealing with these guys with guns pretty easily.
Yes.
They seem to have been to the same school of gun use as the Daredevil thugs.
I think all media thugs kind of go to the same school.
What is this guy thinking? He has, he's in a hand-to-hand fight, maybe close quarters with guns, and he decides to use a grenade.
Also, Batman lets him die.
Yeah. Yeah, but doesn't kill him per se.
Yeah, I know.
Oh, what about that?
That was a nice big slam.
Big slams.
I
are
do
good.
Like that.
Okay, let's keep going.
The problem with this is when the field starts to thin out. Now the knives come out. This is where you see the real difference between Christian Bale's Batman and Ben Affleck's Batman.
Is there a reason he has super...
Look, he's letting somebody shoot at him.
But his suit's armoured.
Yeah, his suit's armoured, but...
Look, he's taking on four guys here and they all have knives. That's very impressive.
Exactly, and he's getting stabbed.
But they're all deflecting off his super costume.
No, see, this is the thing, because I kind of agree with Clive here. I'm a huge Batman fan, and the whole point of Batman is he'd never let that happen.
But he just did.
No.
Look, that looks sore.
Yeah, and see, he got shot in the back of the head.
So what's wrong then? His awareness...
It's that he's become this, he's the guy in a fight or sport or whatever, boxing or whatever, who has now all of a sudden a granite chin and thinks he doesn't have to work on his footwork anymore.
Right, I don't really know what you mean, but okay.
He's like, I can take your punch, you go ahead and punch me and I'm going to punch you back.
Okay, like Moonlight.
All the technique is gone. Instead of, I'm going to evade your punch and I'm going to punch you back.
It's just lazy.
I'm going to put myself in a place where I can punch you and you can't punch me. He's like, yeah, you punched me two or three times, but I got my magic granite chin. I'm not going to get knocked out. So I'll take two to give one.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just a bad strategy for somebody who is a strategic genius.
But maybe this Batman isn't a strategic genius.
But all Batmen are strategic geniuses. Bruce Wayne's character is very firmly written as a strategic genius.
Except this one.
Yeah, because it's pulling from the feckin' Frank Miller Dark Knight Returns Batman. Sorry.
So, to preface this a little bit, the Batman in Zack Snyder's Batman vs. Superman is actually taken from an older version of Batman that was pioneered in the 1980s by Frank Miller. This was right at the time that Frank Miller started going really heavily on ultra-violence.
Ultra-violence!
Kind of. It became very ridiculous, but the premise was that Batman was much older and therefore could no longer depend on his agility or his quickness. And so instead he became far more muscular and brutal.
Well, that's great then. Yeah.
If you read that terrible, terrible comic, and yes, we will get a lot of fanboy hate for this.
Are you calling The Dark Knight Returns
yes.
a terrible comic?
I'm calling it a terrible comic.
Give me your comic podcast license.
Go back and read it.
It has been rescinded.
Go back and read it.
Unless DC would like this podcast.
Yes! Oh. Yes! Clive's on board.
totally down for that, by the way.
Thank you, Clive. Oh, Clive. Anyway, let's talk about the fighting, Clive. Is he doing fighting or is he not doing fighting? What's he doing?
Let's keep going. If I remember this scene,
that looks like a bit of Aikido to me.
Was,
there,
nice little bit of a throw, wrist lock, and now, guy, he's on the ground.
Yeah.
He's not trying to get up. He's just, I can take it, and boom,
Yeah.
Knife right in the shoulder.
Serves him
right. He finally got his comeuppance, trying to be the hard man, taking it all. Now, he comes out on the right side, he just pulls the knife out, but he got a knife in the shoulder all the same. If he was trying to fight Superman now, where would he be?
Fighting Superman's another podcast.
One name dropped from complete salvation.
So, then, do you find this less believable than Daredevil? More? Or just more annoying?
It's more annoying because we've seen so much better from a Batman.
Which one?
Christian Bale's
Batman. Give me an example. Sorry for being so confrontational. Sorry, everybody.
He hasn't recovered from the redhead comment earlier.
Say Batman's final fight with Bane. Do you feel in control?
Impossible.
Someone broke you.
Someone said Bane in a room full of men who like comic book movies.
I would like to point out that none of us cupped our hands over our faces. We should be very proud.
Not one.
But you came back to die with your city.
let's stop that. We just lost 10 subscribers.
Sorry, guys. Thank you for listening for as long as you did.
Batman's final fight with Bane.
Mm-hmm.
It's a thing of beauty. It's strategic.
Mm-hmm.
He starts off, he puts aside what happened before and the whole breaking his back incident.
I'll break the bat.
I'd like to point out that Mick was the one that asked us to stop.
With a little bit German as well.
He starts fighting him at distance. There's kicks, there's punches.
Mm-hmm.
They're using the steps to create separation between. And it's not working out. He's not having much effect on Bane.
Mm-hmm.
So then he starts to close in. He starts to grapple with Bane. Mm-hmm. He starts to get control and hits him a couple of times. Strategic. What I'm doing isn't working. I try something else. Distance doesn't work. Close in. Take the distance away. Now Bane is so strong, he realizes, you know, this grappling with Bane malarkey isn't working. But he stays in close and keeps striking at short range. He switches to elbows and knees, stays in on top of Bane. And it's just a beautiful strategic, leaving aside all the comic book stuff. If you put in just Fighter A and Fighter B, Fighter A has these skills, Fighter B has these skills. Strategically, how should they approach when they don't know how the fight is going to go? That's what Batman would do and should do to win the fight.
So
strategically, he uses his skills in the best, most efficient way as Christian Bale's Batman. Ben Affleck has just decided to become a tank.
Yeah. There we go.
But Ben kind of justified that for us.
I justified it in where they took their character from. I don't think it's a good version of Batman. People like it because most people who read Batman vs. Superman when it first came out were teenagers. And when you're a teenager, it's very, 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 very... I was not. But I was a teenager when I picked it up for the first time. Because when you go to a comic book store and you ask about Batman, everyone will hand you The Dark Knight Returns.
Oh, that's not great.
It's not great. And the interesting thing about The Dark Knight Returns is it's kind of interesting for fans of Batman to see a different version of the Batman. But if it's your introduction to Batman, or if it's something that you're coming in, which is what Batman vs. Superman is for a lot of people in the new...
Oh yeah, it's easy to forget.
Superhero thing. Like, it's pitched towards teenagers more than it's pitched towards us. And then you see Tank Batman, as Clive put it. And it's just really annoying. Batman is a very, very strategic fighter by nature. He's a strategic mastermind. That's what he does. That's his
superpower.
That's, yeah, for lack of an actual one. Yeah. That's his thing. Planning and preparation. And
being really rich.
Being rich. It's in the trailer.
And if you want to see that Batman, you can read Grant Morrison's run on JLA when he goes a little bit too far with that type of Batman as well. He makes Batman into a living supercomputer.
Like the Midnighter.
Who plans... A little bit like that, exactly. I think Midnighter kind of came out of that version of...
Good pun. Midnighter's gay.
Midnighter's gay in the comics. But Midnighter is very much a parody of, I know every move you're going to make, and I will stop you. It's kind of a piss take of that. And it's just...
I like Midnighter.
No, Midnighter's awesome.
No, I feel bad now.
He became his own thing. But the supercomputer Batman is just as irritating. Batman works best when he's just a man who does a lot of preparation.
Cool.
Personally.
We've got one last fight scene to get through. We only got about 5 minutes left here, so let's get it done, guys.
Woo.
Let's rock Watchmen. This. Let's go Watchmen.
This won't need a lot of interruption. We can go straight through. This is glorious.
This is Zack Snyder again, who you didn't like before.
I don't like Zack Snyder. I think he's an awful director.
Oh?
Here comes Silk Spectre. Doesn't do a stupid superhero drop. Does exactly what you should do when you fall like that. Takes down the feet, rolls to take the force out of the fall.
Oh, this is weird. This is the opposite of how I thought it was going to be.
Yeah.
Is that a practical fighting outfit?
Probably not, but you got to suspend your disbelief to an extent. It just makes it more impressive.
So we're watching... Ben, do you want to give us some...
So Watchmen is the 2009 adaptation of what is...
2009!
Oh yeah.
My god, I'm so old.
Zack Snyder is kind of first attempt at proper superheroes. He had done 300 before that, and studios fell in love with him in 300 because he's so in love with green screens, and green screens were a big new thing, and whole movies based in green screen were a big new thing, and you can also see a lot of color correction in this. There's a lot of tones and things like that, so he's very popular. And it's an adaptation of Alan Moore's extremely famous comic. The most postmodern superhero comic in existence.
Okay, here we go.
Now, just pause it there, Mick. Look, straight away, Silk Spectre has kicked that guy. He's not unconscious. He's rolling around, but he's out of it. That's realistic.
Okay.
She kicked him.
She kicked him in a kind of sexy way.
Yeah.
Sex kick. I really wouldn't mind if she did that to me.
If you
again, this is not about you.
If you're watching this scene, she uses an awful lot of kicks.
Okay.
Which is completely reasonable for a female character, because that's the great equalizer.
And she's a big tall lady.
That, yeah, you got to keep distance between somebody who's probably stronger in the upper body, no matter a superhero or not. So you use distance, you use kicks, where there's not as much differential in strength between the legs. She keeps separation. And watch as they progress down this corridor. Just the separation of space and how they never interfere with each other, they cover each other. It's like a beautiful ballet between the two of them.
What's Batman doing here?
He's covering her back. He's watching.
He's definitely looking at her body.
He's looking
there.
At her ass.
No, no, no. He's checking her for weak spots.
She had a hip replacement?
No, she has not.
Okay, let's go.
He's ensuring his fellow warriors.
His fellow warrior.
Beautiful ballet. Look, about to happen.
Caught someone trying to sneak up on her.
What type of kick was that?
Boom. It's a nice, in American parlance, roundhouse kick again.
So they're just going through here.
But
they don't seem to be able to hit her.
That's because she's using her kicks to control the distance.
I think
there's no... like Batman just piling into a crowd of people and hoping you'll tough through. She's going high and low. She's controlling the distance.
She did a little spin there and exposed her weak spot.
She did, but then she did another spin and exposed his face to a kick.
He's punched that last guy in the nuts.
Punched him in the nuts. And look, he's still moving around a little bit. And that was a punch, not just a little zap.
Punch in the nuggets. Oh, look at that. Oh, that didn't really connect, did it? That little spin at the end did hurt him.
So just to be clear, this is actually quite...
I mean, it's not realistic.
No, it's not, because...
if you were fighting in a prison, it's not going to look like this. But in terms of fight choreography...
It's a little bit more...
It makes sense. It's beautiful.
So whoever choreographed this one has a little bit of experience with actual fighting, as opposed to making Scarlett Johansson look even more...
Yeah, just like, you know, putting the pretty girl and all that
choreography
stuff doesn't really make a difference.
Are you saying that Malin Ackerman is less pretty than Scarlett Johansson?
I'm saying in this scene, they're not relying on the fact that one of the characters is a pretty girl.
Huh. That's what got me through it.
Is that she is a pretty girl?
Yeah.
But if you look at it just from, put them in as just two stick figures.
Right.
In your mind.
Mm-hmm. I'm doing that. My eyes are closed.
And just watch the beautiful ballet as they progress down that corridor.
Mm-hmm.
The highs and the lows,
mm-hmm.
covering each other but never interfering with each other. the control of space, timing, distance, to, you know, really effectively use their skills against this onrushing crowd. That is nice choreography.
Cool. Ben, do us a favor. Based on Clive's analysis there, why don't you and I try and rank them?
Okay.
And then we'll get Clive's official answer and then we'll finish up for the week.
Okay, well then, in that case, I suppose, based on Clive's analogy and aesthetic objection to oven mitts, I would...
Don't base it on me. Don't let me sway you.
Okay, yeah, just give, okay. Yeah, what do you think?
Hear my arguments.
For me, it's definitely Daredevil first. I think it's quite...
Clive's very close to you.
Quite good. He is, yeah, he is. And he's got a lot of reach. Did I use that word correctly?
Yes.
Got a lot of reach. Lot of reach. Good. Ah, look, we're learning. Daredevil goes first for me because I quite like that series. It doesn't seem silly to me. Now, unfortunately, Clive, you have affected my decision making in the next part. I would say then that Silk, Spectre, and Night Owl goes at number two because it's not as silly. And then it's kind of a toss-up between Black Widow and Batman for the last two. They're equally as bad as each other. I think because I'm such a Batman fanboy, I should probably remove myself from the fanboy thing and say that Black Widow is last and Batman is third last. Because I'm just annoyed by that representation of Batman, so it shouldn't be...
That seems fair.
Shouldn't sway.
I think I largely agree. I think Watchmen was probably the best, Daredevil second... I thought some of the hits in Daredevil didn't realistically connect as well as they could have, and now I'm really put off by the oven mitts, and then you totally ruined
oven mitts.
Thanks a lot, Clive.
Seconds in,
and Black Widow was definitely the worst.
Just
nothing she did looked like it hurt. Okay, thank you very much, Clive. It was great having you.
Anytime.
Thanks a lot.
We really appreciate it.
Yeah, we'd love to get you back sometime and maybe analyze some more.
I think when Wonder Woman comes out, maybe, because that would be interesting.
How are you on your weapons, Clive?
Yeah, not too bad. Not too bad.
So hopefully we'll get you back in the future to analyze a few more fight scenes, or maybe talk about something else involving the martial arts and pop culture.
Very good.
Thanks very much. Thanks for listening, everybody. If you have any suggestions for fight scenes that Clive could analyze, leave a comment on the YouTube video or
leave us a comment on iTunes.
Leave us a comment on iTunes. SoundCloud. Or send us a tweet at Mick and Ben.
If you want to get Mike from Saskatchewan to send a tweet for you, you can. He's a very agreeable young man. Anyway, that is the end for this week.
Bye.
Bye-bye.